So thank you all for being here, and thanks to the conference committee for inviting me. We've been joking a bit this morning about who's from where, and my connection to Newfoundland and Labrador is that although I live in Vancouver right now, I'm from the Netherlands, for which the acronym is NL. So there you go. So I would like to talk about a resource that I did not make myself, but I'm presenting on behalf of the Provincial Health Services Authority in BC, and they have a resource called Health 201, Five Things That Planners and Design Professionals Need to Know About Health in the Built Environment. And this is a presentation that's available online, so you can use it. And I'm sure you're all familiar with the contents of it, but this is a presentation that you can just use free of charge, so you don't have to look up all the information. And to start, I would like to have some polling questions here. I would like to know who of you has the built environment as one of their responsibilities, who is doing something in this field already? Okay, so there's quite an even distribution. A little bit more people are not working in a built environment yet, and many of them are actually are working in a built environment already. The second question, regardless of your involvement in built environment issues, have you reached out to other departments to work across sectors? Okay, that's quite a large percentage. So I'm going to talk about that a little bit, but for those of you who are not really working on built environment yet, they may be able to use this information. So about this presentation, it is intended to convince local government that built environment is important and that everybody should be doing something in it, although you're not directly responsible for the built environment, because many issues in the built environment can affect health, and we've heard that today, and I'm sure you're all familiar with that. This presentation could be delivered by any planning team member. You could use it to convince other people in local environment that they should care about the built environment. You can make it any length you want. The recommended length is about 30 minutes, so this is the full presentation that I'm going to talk about, but I'll just zip through many of the slides. And so, as I said, it's available on PHSA's website. I'll give you the web link later. So it starts with some key messages about the built environment. Being that the planning sector and the local government are already doing a lot of work that eventually affect the built environment. Injury and illness have huge impacts on health of people, and I'm sure you already know that. And we've also heard before that it's everyone's job to do something about the built environment, and that healthy choices are not necessarily the easiest choices, and that we should work to change that. And as I said, good planning and design can help people avoid or change unhealthy physical environments. So what the presentation does is it goes through five things that the professionals in planning should know about the built environment. The first one being the impact of chronic illness and disease is immense. And so each of these five things is illustrated with examples. Usually they are from BC because this is a presentation from BC, but you can insert any local figures that you like. So the impact, it is enormous. So for BC, for example, it's about half of the provincial budget goes to healthcare. And all the money that is spent on healthcare can no longer go to other departments because you can only spend each dollar once. So this presentation... Sorry. So this is about how you... Yeah, so this is basically, this summarizes why planners should care about health costs being so high. You can only spend it once, and every dollar that goes to healthcare does not go to other areas. So if you can divert that money into prevention, that's good. And it was, this is just a figure of BC, 49% goes to healthcare. Catherine already mentioned 46% of dollars go to healthcare in Ontario. So I'm sure the figures for Newfoundland Labrador are pretty similar. So this is a slide that shows some of the health data. There's one graph for women and one for men, and you can see that the higher the body mass index, the greater the risk for all types of diseases, chronic diseases, especially diabetes type 2. And another important message is that many injuries that occur can be prevented by good design, and it's as easy as building sidewalks, having them, and getting people to use them in a safe way. So the first one was health. The health impacts of the built environment are huge, and it's costly too. So why are some people healthy while others are not? It's not about choice. It's not all about choice. And that was also mentioned this morning. Not all people have the choice to live where they want to live. Some people have more environmental exposures and not so great built environments that they live in. But you have to try to make the healthy choice the easy choice, although changing behavior is not easy. So that's why you have to do something about the built environment. So this is a figure from BC that shows health status, that unequal distribution of health issues. And you can see the darker areas are that they have more inequalities in health. So that's two. One, the impact is enormous. Two, not everybody has a choice. Three, many sectors of society influence public health. And it's not just healthcare, it's all about all sorts of other sectors. The way we shape our societies in the broadest sense of the word has an impact on population health. And it's, most of the planners get that, but it's just good to emphasize it a bit more. And also, like I mentioned earlier, this is a slide that just represents individual individual action that you want to do to change health, but socioeconomic factors make it harder. So if you can improve the healthy built environment for many people, then you're going to have greater impacts, that ripple effect that was discussed earlier today. The fourth one, I'm sure you're familiar with this one. The built environment has an impact on health. That can be about traffic safety, walkability, access, but also things like green space and mixed use. And here are some more pictures that illustrate that. Cars, congestion, air pollution, sprawling neighborhoods, bad design, bad sidewalks. And this, again, illustrates that ripple effect. If you can have an influence on public policies, then you're going to have an impact on plans, which is eventually going to have an impact on behavior and then on health. And it's not directly measurable, and it's not measurable in the short term, but it will be measurable in the longer term. So that's 4 points. And then the fifth is collaboration is necessary to create healthy built environments, and that's why I asked this question, who is collaborating across sectors? And many of you are doing that already, but it's good to realize that it's not always obvious that people do that, so it's so do keep reaching out and try to convince others. And an example of cross-sectoral collaboration was tobacco control. This is a figure. Can we go back one? No. One of the slides is missing there. Anyway, it showed a figure. It was a graph, and the first tobacco use was going up, and then it was going down, and there were multiple sectors that had an influence on the reduction of cigarettes smoked per day, And that had to do with education campaigns, it had to do with taxes, and it had to do with a lot of health research coming out. Oh, this was the one. So here you can see all the dips are represented in this figure that shows how tobacco use went down eventually. And this is also possible with the built environment. But again, this may not be as easy to measure. So health sector and planners have many opportunities for collaboration on in many fields. In environmental health factors, air and water quality, stormwater runoff, noise, heat, housing, quality of housing, affordability of housing, that will all impact health. And you have to keep working with those other people to get things done in a built environment. Injury prevention, we already discussed that. Physical activity, nutrition, and food security. This is a summary of the areas where you can work together. So this is, again, the five key messages that I showed in the beginning. The planning sector and health professionals already have a huge impact on built environments and just keep working in that field. Chronic and illness and injury are a risk to public health and the healthcare system because it's really a burden on the system. And promoting healthy lifestyles alone is not enough. You have to make the healthy choice the easy choice. And professionals working in health planning and design share a responsibility to promote active living and modify the built environment. And you have to have the good planning in place to help people avoid unhealthy environments. So thank you very much.